So hello everyone, today I'm going to talk about how building smaller Go binaries, but first let's talk about Go binaries themselves. Go binaries are very cool for beginners, especially for newcomers to the Go language or even as their first language, because they are very small, or we put that in question. They have everything included, from the runtime, scheduler, to dependencies, and they are portable because they don't have almost any operating system levels or libraries. But as I said, they are really small. Here are some samples. Just to print a hello world, we need about 1 megabyte binary, but we can make the same example like a hello world via HTTP in less than 6 megabytes, unless you start dealing directly or indirectly with Kubernetes or other big projects when you skyrocket your binary over 20 megabytes. So what we have inside a Go binary we can get rid of? There are two mainly things, probably more, but these are the two more important I found. First is the dwarf table. The dwarf table contains some debug symbols, and the symbol table, which has, depending on the architecture you are building, you are compiling, has more reference on others. We don't need this in release versions, and we are going to drop them. So we just use this common Unix command, strip, and the name of our binary, or compiled binary. No. We mustn't use that. Why? Strip does produce random panics on Go binaries, so we better use Golang own tools, so we can use an LD flag called -s and the name of our binary. But here is a small behave different on other platforms. If we don't use any flags, we have 3 megabytes. If we use -w, we remove the dwarf tables, but we use -s, we remove the dwarf tables and all the rest. It doesn't work on Mac, but it does work on Linux, so it depends on the architecture you are using. LD flags doesn't remove or obfuscate your stack traces. It will keep on your program because they are needed for reflection. And with that, we drop it 20% average. It depends on your binary size of your binary final size. Now what? What can we do more? We must do binary compression. Remember the asterisk. There is a tool called UPX. It stands for Ultimate Package Packer for Executables. It's based on UCL, which embeds a tiny decompressor inside the final binary. And it's very fast and efficient because it doesn't need extra memory allocation for decompression. When compressing, we must just type UPX and the name of our binary. We can use the stripped binary, and it will reduce to a 28% ratio. Of course, there are two flags, like best and ultra brute, to compress even more. But I will talk about that later. There is a new compression delay on each run. Yes, depending on the binary size, the algorithm used, or the architecture. It's not the same using ARM or other architectures. Here are the results. If we use default, we have the 10% of the original size stripped between 60 and 80%. With UPX normal, we take about 7 seconds to compress, 100 milliseconds to start running, and 24 of the final size. If we use UPX brute, we take about 7 or 8 minutes to compress, and just about 200 more milliseconds. But if you need for specific platforms, you can do that. So remember the asterisk. Binary compression is not as good as it can be. Compressing the binary can be viewed as obfuscating the code. So it can be viewed bad by some protection software like antivirus. And don't compress the bin data if you are using UPS, because it will compress twice and you will degrade the performance. That's all. Enjoy the conference and thank you.